Hello everyone, thank you for listening in to the virtual conference at PETS and my talk, DeFi, an improved high-speed network layer anonymity protocol. This is joint work with my colleague Alexander Bajic, and the research is supported by our industry partner Rheinmetall. So what's the agenda of today's talk? At first, I'm trying to motivate you why you should look into, why you should be interested in lightweight anonymous routing, and a short introduction what that is. Then I'm going to talk about the FEE protocol, which is a protocol we are basing our work on. One of the contributions in our paper were attacks on it. So we present the outline of the attacks and the improvements, how we can defend against them. At the end of the talk, I'm going to talk about a little bit about anonymity analysis. How can you do that? And the challenges involved, which might also be interesting for other researchers, not necessarily working on lightweight anonymity, but on other anonymous routing protocols. So why should we use anonymous routing? I think in this community, I don't really have to go into too much detail. The metadata, who communicates with whom, is extremely valuable information. That's what many people are after in the first place. Our current internet infrastructure and other network infrastructure essentially doesn't hide that information at all. So it's easy to collect, to find out who is communicating with whom, if you somehow can eavesdrop on the communication or infiltrate routing infrastructure. The typical use case or typical motivation why should we care about anonymous routing is mass surveillance. It's quite easy to set up mass surveillance in the internet, collect who is communicating with whom, with quite severe consequences for civilians if they're, for example, in a non-democratic state. In the literature, this is basically most people talk about this motivating factor and how we can introduce anonymity into the internet infrastructure. I wanted to briefly mention that there's also another spin to that. With is essentially, we were asked by industry partner to look into it, not for to prevent mass surveillance, but actually to secure corporate corporate networks, WANs and LANs. Why should you do that? Basically, also for an attacker that wants to infiltrate a network, who is communicating with whom is extremely important and valuable information. And if you hide this information, you can essentially hamper the reconnaissance phase of the attacker and lateral movement and make it much harder for the attacker to reach its target. And that is, can be, for example, the case if you compromise the router in the network, or if you look at WANs, large corporate networks, international corporate networks, if one side has been compromised, it might be important to prevent an attacker in that compromised infrastructure to find out the entire network flow of the network and the important targets. So I just want to mention that this is a topic that has not been really looked into too much, why you want to use lightweight anonymity protocols, but I really wanted to note to you that besides mass surveillance and the internet, corporate WANs and LANs is also something this technology can be very interesting and interested for. That was generally about anonymous routing, so preventing somebody to find out who's communicating with whom at what time. So one question might be, why not simply use Tor? I'm stealing this this nice table from Chen's 2017 talk that introduced PHY, which essentially shows that yes, we have great anonymity protocols that can prevent anonymity to certain degrees, but it usually comes with huge performance trade-offs. And a lot of research kind of tries to make anonymity better and better and better, but what lightweight anonymity looks at is basically the left part. Let's say, okay, we want anonymity, but the performance that is required in many networks doesn't allow us to integrate these anonymity protocols that have been proposed. So, okay, let's focus on performance over anonymity so that we can actually integrate it at a large scale into these networks. And that is basically the research that we are looking into. So what is lightweight anonymous routing? At the network layer, we want speeds like 100 gigabits per second. We want really low latency. One important part is that we don't want a per flow state to ensure that there's, for example, no denial of services. If you have the internet, for example, there's so many flows going on, you don't want one routing node to store all the flows because that might be a bottleneck. And we want to be able to incorporate it into the network architectures. So we want it at the network layer so that you can use different applications on that. And essentially have small path lengths and not this overhead that you have with onion routing where you have multiple hops. So the path lengths and the traffic in the entire network increases quite a bit. So this is a rough motivation. So lightweight anonymity protocols have been proposed. The first one has been basically proposed in 2012, LAP. It only has sender anonymity. So it only protects who sends a message, but not the destination. It's extremely efficient as it doesn't have any kind of public key cryptography. In 2014, Dovetail was proposed also here at PETS. It includes partial receiver anonymity. So half of the nodes, basically the nodes closer to the destination know the receiver, but not the other nodes. But it requires source control networking architecture, namely pathlets. In 2017, Phi was proposed also at PETS. One great advantage of that compared to Dovetail was that you can use it with different routing policies. And particularly you can use value-free routing policies with that, which is important because the internet infrastructure today is based on value-freeness to do the billing. Additionally, it does hide also the distance to the source and destination. So how many hops have passed, which is an important, which can quite increase anonymity quite a bit. We later see numbers for that. And also has some other features like it can link a session ID to a secure key to prevent man-in-the-middle attacks. So now I'm going to try to give a short introduction of the Phi protocol. We're going to do that with a little example. We have a source here that wants to communicate with the destination D. And the first thing that happens in this protocol is that we choose a helper node anywhere in the network. In this case, it's we choose A12 as the helper node M. And now we send S sends M a message with the destination D encrypted in the payload so that nobody learns the real destination, but M. And important is that all paths on the nodes, so these are the nodes that pass the message to M, stores the routing information, which, so the ingress, for example, A4 stores the ingress A8, the message came from A8, and I forwarded it to A8. The message came from A1, and I have to forward it to A8, and stores that in routing information, encrypts this routing information, and stores this in a routing segment. So that later on, if it receives the same header, it can decrypt this information and knows how to process this this message without having to store anything themselves because everything is stored in the header. So the message has reached M, so it needs to reach D, right? So what happens, M could send it directly to D, but then we might violate like this value freeness. The resulting path might be longer than necessary. So the first step is M decrypts, of course, the destination. And then it starts something called the backtracking phase. To do that, it sends the message back to the previous node, which is A9. And A9 essentially looks into, should I send the message to D? Or according to the routing policy, preferable to send it back to A8? It's the ingress, right? The message came from A8, so it knows it came from A8. It doesn't know the other nodes, but it knows A8. For example, it could look at what is the shortest route from A8 to D? What is the shortest route from A9 to D? What is longer? So to decide how to route it. Let's say in this case, A8 made sense that the message was sent to A8. A8 now, again, should I become the midway node? So the message that now forwards, ends the backtracking, forwards it to destination D. And we can see kind of, it does make sense for node A8 to forward it instead of sending it back. So A8 decides to become the midway node and sends now the message to D. Over this path, an important part again is that all of these nodes store the routing information the same way as the nodes that sends on the way to the helper node. And the midway node updates its routing information to know, okay, from now on, I forward it to A11. So then we have this green path from S to D, and all the necessary routing information is stored in the header, encrypted with the keys of the individual routing nodes, so that nobody that that gets a header knows how is routing done, but each node receiving such a header that is in the routing path can proceed it. So who learns what? We learn essentially the nodes between the source and the midway node learn and don't learn the destination, but the nodes between the midway node and the destination learn the destination. And nobody learns the source besides the entry node. So this is kind of partial receiver anonymity and larger sender anonymity. Okay, that was the WAF idea of Phi. Now I'm going to briefly outline some attacks. For detailed analysis, please have a look at the paper. One problem was is passive distance equal to destination. Routing elements in the routing segment in Phi are inserted in a pseudo-random position. So the routing segment is first initialized with random dummy entries, and then at random positions, pseudo-random positions, the routing segments are loaded. And that essentially an attacker that eavesdrops, intercepts a packet, doesn't know how many entries have real routing information which have dummy routing information, and so it doesn't learn the distance to the sender. However, an attacker can simply store this header, and when the message is returned back the first time, it can look at how many entries have changed, and the number of changed entries is essentially the distance to the destination, or rather the distance to the helper node plus the distance to the destination. We also have several active attacks. The main idea simply is we modify routing segments, routing elements in the routing segment, and observe if messages still reach the communication partner. If it still does, then we have not destroyed important routing information. This way we can kind of find out which elements have dummy information, which don't have dummy element information, and that during transmission we can find out, for example, which the position of the midway node. During the handshake reply, we can find the distance to the source. We have to do some further tricks to ensure that the message only reaches once the source. But essentially, by doing these active attacks, we can find out the distances to the source and the destination. We also have an attack in an extended threat model where the attacker controls clients. The original threat model only assumes an attacker has access to a malicious routing node. In the internet infrastructure and many other network cases, it's reasonable that the attacker controls several clients, like, for example, proxy server in the internet. And then basically we can use fake backtracking messages with different addresses to these server-controlled clients to drastically decrease the anonymity set size in this advanced threat model. So these are kind of the summary of the attacks. Again, for more details, please have a look at the paper. So we also have some improvements to defend against these attacks. Mainly, we changed how the routing segments are inserted and handled. We now have a circular insertion in the routing segments with a random starting position. We split the routing segment into two parts, one from source to midway node, one from midway node to destination to prevent this passive distance leakage. We also changed the backtracking to go all the way to the source. And these changes are essentially done to add several integrity checks of the routing segment that basically detects these active attacks. We also have included a way for the source to verify that the correct destination has been used to prevent these malicious client attacks. And we use fresh IVs and authenticated encryption to ensure that that you can that all encryptions are fresh, which was an issue in the fee protocol. Circular insertion is an example. So again, we split this routing segment into two parts. We choose a random starting position. So an attacker doesn't know how many segments have been inserted before, but the source essentially that does know how many routing segments roughly should have been added can verify that these nodes have not been added. And the midway node, in this case, it was A8, is kind of in both segments and does the linking between the two. And the midway node knows the destination. So if midway node is malicious, it doesn't really matter that V2, which essentially protects information to the destination, is compromised. But again, please have a look at the paper for the details if you're interested. I just wanted now to roughly quickly mention entity set size analysis, because of course we were also asked, okay, give us number, how much do the attacks improve security or anonymity? And the main message I wanted to give here is that extremely hard to fairly compare different protocols because it depends on so much, so many different factors, particularly the network layout, the routing policy is very important, the location of the attacker is important, and particularly if you have protocols that might not have a helper node, how do you compare that fairly? We used a simulation approach to tackle this problem based on MATLAB, where we choose 1,000 random source and destination pairs, generated then a fee path, and then computed for all of these 1,000 examples the NUBI set size if an attacker was located of any of these nodes on the path. And I've compared it to different protocols. Important part again, we have the paper, we have the MATLAB code submitted as an artifact to this paper. So if you want to experiment with it, please have a look at it. This might also be interesting for you if you do other research in anonymous routing outside of lightweight anonymous routing. This is an example how the result looks like. I will not go into detail what that actually means. We have different protocols here compared. I just wanted now here take a look at this part. Where essentially the solid line is our improved protocol, the dashed line is the fee protocol, and we can see that our improved protocol increases anonymity set size. So we want it basically the further it's to the bottom right, the better. But more effect as more important is the location. These are different locations. The colors are different locations within the path. And that has a more drastic effect on the anonymity set size than whether or not the distance is leaked. So I just wanted to show you that you really have to take into account various factors. And one simple number is not really that meaningful in such an analysis. Here's an example where we choose different routing policies, and it has also drastic influence. We see the yellow one here is if we allow every valid path to be valid, so we don't have shortest path routing. So a path that is 9 hops is as likely as a path that is 4 hops long. And that of course increases anonymity drastically, but it also of course is unrealistic in most networks, and decreases performance. So again, if you want to analyze it fairly, you really have to look into details. What kind of assumptions do you make? And that's like the simulation can be quite helpful for you also to get a feeling what influences what, how much. So again, take a look at the paper and the code if you want. We also looked at performance. Roughly speaking, performance of fee and DeFi is so similar that basically it's not a big difference. It's very efficient. We also compared it with Hornet, which is a really great efficient protocol with very high security, anonymity, but it's a sender, a source has a routing policy based on the source. So the source does the routing, which is not applicable into many networks, but it's essentially still a great paper. Code is available also for this analysis, so have a look at it. So that's all I really wanted to say. There are several open questions. We haven't really solved the problem, but I hope I kind of have motivated you that this is a very interesting topic, not just to prevent mass surveillance, but it's also applicable to large corporate networks. So if you're interested, please have a look at the paper. It's an interesting topic. A lot of research, still research questions open. So with that, I close. If you have any question, you can reach me via email. Thank you very much for your attention and have a nice day.